Hello all, I welcome you to this video lecture series on the nonlinear modeling and analysis for performance-based seismic design of structures. In this lecture, we will discuss about the performance-based seismic design and assessment of structures, its basic introduction, and what is this process all about. We will have an overview of some of the important concepts in the performance-based seismic assessment, and we will have an overview of its process also. So let's start. The material for the preparation of these lecture slides are mostly taken from Dr. Naveed Anwar and Professor Dr. Panang Varnichai from Asian Institute of Technology. Some of the other references are also mentioned, and I duly acknowledge all the sources. These slides are mostly taken from the lecture notes and lecture slides of these two professors, and I thank them for allowing me to use these in my training material. So my plan will be that I will start with historical background, some of the historical developments in the seismic performance philosophy, and then which led to the basic philosophies of seismic design of structures, some of the revisions, for example, for you, and then from code-based design to performance-based design. This topic will highlight some of the motivations for the development of performance-based design, some of the limitations which the code-based design have, and the performance-based design philosophy is developed as a result of these limitations or some of the shortcomings of traditional building codes, and some of the motivations which led to the development of performance-based seismic design and some of the limitations of traditional building codes. And then we will discuss about what performance-based design and assessment process is. It will be just an introduction, and then some of the other ideas which are kind of related to performance-based design but some new concepts in the area of seismic design philosophies, and some future trends towards the end. My focus will be on performance-based design assessment, its basic methodology, and this will be just an introduction only. This lecture will not make you an expert in performance-based design. It will just introduce you towards some of the basic ideas and the overview of the methodology itself. I will focus mainly on what it takes to learn this methodology, mostly the nonlinear modeling and analysis of structures. So my focus will be on some of the elements or some of the skills which are required to undergo this design philosophy or to perform this assessment on some real structures. So starting with the historical background, I will start with very basic discussion, and then please bear with me until we reach towards the performance-based seismic design. And obviously these historical events or some basic detail is necessary to connect with the development of some of the latest design philosophies in order to have a complete picture of our understanding of these structures. So if we have an overview of what we structural engineers or structural designers basically do in our daily day-to-day routine of structural design, we must observe that the beginning of structural engineering must have originated or started with the recognition of some loads, and the fact that loads have an effect on members, we call them load effects, and those load effects have something to do with the structure performance, and the material with which the structure is made of have some resistance, some inherent resistance against those load effects, and the idea that there is some relationship between those load effects and that inherent resistance between among the materials which constitute that structure. So basically we have load effects on one side. Load effects can be in our normal day-to-day routine, can be shear forces, bending moments, axial forces, torsional effects, or anything. And on the other side we have resistance to those load effects. So the whole thing is to find a relationship between these load effects and the resistance. what kind of that relationship is, or is it linear or non-linear, or whatever are the factors which affect this relationship. These are our primary discussions, or these are our kind of daily routine or design office practice. But the modern structural engineering, it basically originates or started the origins of structural analysis. Currently we can trace it back to the times of Newton, who invented calculus, and then calculus helped the early researchers in solving some of the problems related to structural dynamics and the theory of sound and acoustics. And then in late 19th century or in early 20th century, those concepts of structural dynamics, they came into the earthquake engineering, and we studied them in order to calculate the response of structures against random dynamic forces and earthquakes. So it originated from this guy. And then if we see the evolution of our understanding, we started with the limits on the allowable stresses. For example, the working stress design method, we know that already. Then we started considering the partial factor of safety explicitly, which led to the development of limit state design principles and the formation of ultimate strength design, in which we recognize that the partial factor of safety should be applied to forces, and some part of it should be applied to the material side or the capacity side of the equation. Then in late 19th century, we have the recognition of difference between brittle and ductile failure modes. And then we also have the introduction of capacity-based design in the late 20th century, and then which led to the performance-based design and more explicit linkage between demand and structural performance. And nowadays we are hearing more about some of the fancy interdisciplinary ideas, for example, risk-integrated-based design or consequence-based engineering, etc. Our focus will mainly be on performance-based seismic design, but these new concepts, we have time, we will try to at least define them or see some of the elements introduced from other interdisciplinary areas in the structural engineering. So we will discuss mostly on this, in this side, something about capacity-based design and the performance-based design. We can define this whole thing, first few developments, as the time in which the codes, building codes, primarily govern the structural design, and then some of the new ideas about capacity-based design and performance-based design. Some of the early developers or researchers which have made significant contributions towards what we have nowadays, for example, D. L. Embert first studied the dynamics of simple structures, the concept behind the dynamic equilibrium, and the formulation of mathematical models for structural dynamics of simple structures. And then we have Lagrange, which studied the dynamical systems, and he also one of the earlier investigators in the solution of some of the complex dynamic equations of motions. He was the one who first proposed this idea that the solution of dynamic equations of motion can be studied by superposing some of the waves and the complex structural response or response of any object can be decomposed into some simple waves. Lord Rayleigh, on the other hand, developed the acoustic theory, which is also one of the offshoots of some of the early developments in the calculus and dynamics of simple objects. The theory of sound, one of his famous books, developed this theory, and then it was later brought into the earthquake engineering or understanding the response of structures in the start of 20th century by Arturo Danuso. And then we have in 1932 a major development where the analysis procedure based on the summation of modes or simple single degree of freedom systems was developed by this researcher, who was a Belgian American researcher, and he proposed the method which later became the response spectrum analysis procedure in his PhD thesis, and that was under another well-noted mathematician, Theodor von Karman. So these are some of the early developments which led to the basic development of structural dynamics theory into understanding the response of structures against earthquakes. In around mid 20th century, we have the moment distribution method, and that was developed by Professor Hardy Cross, that remained the primary analysis procedure before wider acceptance of finite element analysis. One of his statements about standardization and building codes is very interesting, and I found it in this lecture by Professor Jack Maley, and that lecture is also available on YouTube. You can watch that interesting discussion about some of the developments in performance-based seismic design and how it affects the seismic design philosophies nowadays in the era of high-rise buildings and complex shapes and geometries. So one of his statements about standardization or building codes is worth mentioning here in the context of performance-based design. In 1952, he says that as the size and complexity of projects increased, it became desirable and even necessary to set up a series of routine procedures for analysis and design. With those standardized formulas and specifications and methods, it became possible to use a greater number of men and men with less training to produce engineering works. This is very noteworthy statement. A greater number of men and men with less training to produce engineering works. Standardization as a check on fools and rascals, or set up as an intellectual assembly line, has served well in the engineering world. By fools, he mean that the people who don't know anything about structural design and still they hold positions as designers or engineers. And by rascals, he mean the people who know too much, but they just want to get away with something. So he's saying that standardization is a check on those people. And that standardization, or the standardized formulas and specifications and methods, it became possible to use a greater number of men and men with less training to produce engineering works. So this gives some idea about some of the early building codes or the intentions, or Professor Jack Maley didn't comment on that, but this statement according to him is kind of shocking in the context of the building codes and the development of standards and formulas and cookbook type of prescribed equations and methods. So I also leave it to yourself to think about it, that what we do, especially when we follow a prescriptive building code or a cookbook type of building code to produce engineering design. In later 20th century, we have some of the researchers, for example, Ray Clough, who is one of the founders of finite element analysis, and some of the early developments in earthquake engineering done by Professor Edward Wilson. So the summary is that we started with intuitive design, and then we have a code-based design. Now we have another more advanced philosophy for structural design, and that is performance-based design, about which we will discuss now. And then we also have consequence or risk-based design and resilience-based design. These are the ideas which mostly come from disaster resilience, or in the context of disaster prevention, mitigation, and management. Our focus mostly will be here, performance-based design. But the idea, basic idea behind that may not be understood before we understand the code-based design or some of the limitations of code-based design, which led to the development of this new design philosophy. So in order to give you an example, I have taken this slide from one of the Pacific Earthquake Engineering Research Institute seminars, and this is also a very interesting example. This is the very first so-called building code, or we also call it the Hammurabi's code, who was the king of Babylon in this 1792 BC, this long time back, ancient time. And the one of the clauses about the building construction in that first so-called code is that if a builder builds a house for someone and does not construct it properly, and the house which he built falls in and kills its owner, then that builder shall be put to death. this is so explicit, so straightforward. Now the code leaves that discussion about what is meant by a properly constructed house. But that code implicitly puts a requirement here, and also it gives the consequence of what will happen if the building doesn't perform in a way which the owner might want it to perform. So if the building falls, and the builder shall be straight away put to death. So these requirements or consequence of non-performance is what is actually required. The building codes, what they do is that they put detailed prescriptive requirements, and that implicitly ensures that the structure will perform well. But they don't put an explicit check on whether the real design, which is the output of that prescriptive requirements, will actually pass that check or not. So that explicit check is not there in building codes. But if we see the requirements from public, that is performance, and that is not the check that you comply to some building code or not. The owner or the general public, that is interested only in the structural performance. So for example, if I compare again an example, the modern building codes would simply say that you should have a parapet which must have these requirements. It should be this much thick, it should be made of that material. But look at this statement from again some ancient times, the Law of Moses. It says that in case you build a new house and you must also make a parapet for your roof, that you may not place blood guilt upon your house because someone falling might fall from it. So it's simply performance oriented. It doesn't tell you that how much height should be there and how much thickness and what material should be used. It's simply performance oriented. So the idea is that ultimately the performance of the structure is what is required. All the explicit or implicit prescriptive requirements and all the limitations and checks, they are only to ensure the structural performance. The early building codes, which were not prescriptive in nature, they were focusing on performance, not the compliance to some particular clause or some provisions. So these two examples are enough to tell us that performance is what is required ultimately. Our building industry nowadays, it relies primarily on codes and standards. And these codes and standards basically specify requirements. They give acceptable solutions, and then they prescribe detailed procedures, some rules or limits, or some procedures in the form of charts or tables or design aids. And they are mostly based either on experience or some detailed experimentation or some detailed analysis. And the spirit of the code is to provide public safety and convenience. And it is assumed that if you comply to the letter of the code, you will meet that spirit. So this is a basic assumption behind those code requirements or limits or rules. They define different appropriate or estimated hazard or load levels for which structures should be designed. They prescribe limits on structural systems, members or materials. They define different analysis and design procedures, and they also provide rules for detailing, for example, and specifications for construction and monitoring. So hope that all of this will lead to reduced vulnerability and safer structures. But the point is that there is no explicit check that all of these requirements, if fulfilled, will result in the desired structural performance or not. That explicit check is not there. So there is a basic assumption that if you follow these checks and rules and procedures, your design will be safe. So nowadays, the modern building codes, which intend to make buildings safe for public, they look like this. That, for example, the clauses are highly prescriptive, just like a cookbook type, that you should do this, you should do that. This should not be less than this, that should not be less than that. For example, the inside diameter of bend in welded wire reinforcement for stirrups and ties shall not be less than 4 dB, where dB is the die of the bar. but it doesn't tell what will happen if the inside diameter of bend in welded wire increase from this 4 dB. What will happen if it increase to 4.2 dB or 4.1 dB? That explicit check is not there. So the prescriptive nature of building codes, they have extremely detailed procedures, prescriptions and equations, and that seems arbitrary, rounded off limits with implicit meaning. And that meaning is that if you follow these provisions, the letter of the code, ultimately you will result in a safe design. So structural engineers are trained to follow the procedures and equations and rules, and they are trained to be conformists. For example, architects, on the other hand, they are encouraged to dream and to be defined, unlike the structural engineers. To give you an example of this, for example, if we have a question that determine the wall thickness and reinforcement of a 6x2x3 box of reinforced concrete, most structural engineers should be able to do that. It is easy for us to determine the wall thickness and the reinforcement and detailing. But if we rephrase that question and we say that, okay, design the most cost-effective water tank to hold 36 meter cube of water, the same volume here. So if we ask to design the most cost-effective water tank, most structural engineers may not be able to follow that. We need what we call as a structural designer. Basically, Dr. Naveed gives this example often to explain some of the skills or requirements to be a structural designer and to go beyond what a typical structural engineer is. So we need to have what we call as a structural designer to answer this question. But what if we again change this question and we rephrase it to design the most cost-effective, beautiful and amazing water tank to hold 36 meter cube of water? Now we have performance, we have cost, and we also have aesthetics. So Dr. Naveed used to give an example that now we have to have a structural artist in order to answer this question or to fulfill this requirement. So we have a typical structural engineer, we have a structural designer, and we also have a structural artist, which must take into account the effect of aesthetics and other requirements along with structural performance and safety requirements. So the code level will always be at this level or maximum here. The code will always give you a prescriptive solution of questions like this. But you have to go beyond that in order to be a structural designer or structural artist. So with this background, let's quickly review some of the basic philosophies of seismic design of structures. And with this quick review, we will again come back to this concept or this idea that building codes have some limitations, and those limitations led us to the development of performance-based seismic design approach.